Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for tuning into our TEDx Countdown event. I'm Marc Schaus, and I'm taking part in Countdown because while you've probably heard a lot about climate change by now, and all the trouble that we're in trying to deal with it at this point, there's a solid chance that you haven't yet heard about another side of the climate conversation that is equally crucial in trying to get more people to talk about. And that's the side of the conversation in which we actually talk about what we're going to do here to solve the climate crisis. So my daily work involves combing through new academic publications coming in from all around the world in about a dozen different scientific fields, literally every day, every month of the year. And what the bird's eye view of all of that new incoming scientific data looks like, especially pertinent to climate change, is that yeah, there's a lot of bad news that we could be talking about here, but that there's also a lot of good news that we could be talking about in terms of human progress towards various climate solutions. Moreover, that progress has actually been picking up pace over the last several years, especially because as more nations have come to recognize climate change as the existential threat that it is, and more scientists have dedicated themselves to the various tasks we need to overcome to solve this problem, the trickle pace of new scientific innovations that we've been seeing for clean energy over the years has picked up pace considerably now, leading into the present. And what that looks like, that progress, is in new scientific innovations, new technological upgrades that are allowing us to transition away from fossil fuel energy sources more towards clean energy sources to cut our carbon emissions. And so while cleaning up our energy sector is not everything with this problem, it is a huge part of it. And the good news is that new progress has been coming in for all of our clean energy options all across the board. Anywhere from the staples of clean energy like solar and wind to 24/7 continuous forms of renewable energy that fewer of us tend to talk about, like geothermal energy and tidal energy and other clean energy sources like nuclear energy and hydrogen fuel and advancements in new biofuels as well. There have been so many dramatic new innovations in clean energy technologies over the last several years that I can realistically only give you a highlights montage in the amount of time that I have here to really try and do any of them justice. So if you're ready for that, consider solar energy specifically. Solar cell technology has been improved so dramatically and fallen so steeply in cost that some analysts expect humanity to be producing tens of thousands of new solar panels per hour over at least the next half decade. And that because scientists and engineers have managed to improve everything from solar cells being more powerful, more efficient, more durable, longer lasting, and especially cheaper, developing communities all around the world can much more readily access this technology, even in place of a new fossil fuel energy plant, driving the demand further. So, I mean, those kinds of things, making technology better and cheaper, is really what will spur more people into wanting to use it, rather than just immoralizing people into using it. So, I mean, even more recently, scientists have managed to create transparent solar cells that could be placed in glass greenhouse rooftops and integrated into the windows of your home, or all along the window sides of skyscrapers in our cities. Or, you know, we even have some engineers developing solar canopies to line select patches of you know, select highway routes. And other new innovations, we even have new solar panels now that not only allow homeowners to harvest renewable energy for their homes off the grid, but they also gather the moisture in the surrounding air to collect clean drinking water for your home at the same time. And the company developing those panels has now even partnered with remote communities in water-scarce parts of the world to try and bring them more clean energy and more clean drinking water at the same time. And those are exactly, again, the kinds of innovations that you would want to see in terms of spurring more use of this technology. Or how about new indoor solar cells that harvest lower levels of indoor ambient light to power microelectronics and, you know, room sensors and thermostats and even security systems? Or how about whole new locations for placing our solar cells, like on floating, buoyant solar pads that rest atop, you know, bodies of water, so-called photovoltaics, that can rest on lakes and reservoirs, or, you know, on top of running rivers that are also supplying hydroelectric energy at the same time, or, of course, all along shorelines in parts of the world where, you know, spare land is in short supply, where you get the added benefit of cool operating temperatures, you know, raising cell efficiency levels, and the massive added benefit of not needing to go and demo huge swaths of land first to make way for your massive new solar farm. Or how about new so-called anti-solar panels that take advantage of the fact that sun's rays hit the Earth's surfaces and a sizable portion of that energy just gets absorbed as thermal energy, hot sunny day, hot surfaces, and that slowly over time that heat dissipates back into space. Anti-solar panels capture some of that heat energy on its reverse passage back out into space. Now, obviously, it's not a monumental amount of energy at that point, but new studies cite getting about 25% of what you would get from your traditional solar cell, which, I mean, is a marked improvement over the 0% of energy we're harvesting overnight from our rooftop panels right now. Now, obviously, we can do more with sunlight than just rooftop panels and transparent energy harvesters. We can also look to nature and learn from plants and trees and other photosynthetic organisms like algae, and learn from photosynthesis in either trying to get those organisms to produce just a little bit more of the energy that they produce and maybe share some of it with us, or mimic the process with advanced new technology in artificial photosynthesis. Now, in terms of the former, scientists have obviously long recognized that plants and trees and other photosynthetic organisms like algae, they take in sunlight, draw in CO2, and use them to generate their own energy while producing the biomass that we see on the outside. If we harvest the energy that's stored in that biomass, burning it would be one way, and then we capture the carbon that's also stored in there at the same time, we can find ourselves in the admirable situation of being able to generate energy while lowering CO2 levels. That is the immense promise of new biofuels. Now, obviously, that's been a tricky situation to find ourselves on the carbon negative side of, or else we'd be doing it already. And biofuels themselves have gotten a lot of bad press recently in some high-profile documentaries, but those almost exclusively focus on just the most poorly planned biofuel facilities that we've ever had, and in no way showcase the real potential, the best-case scenario with biofuel facilities. I mean, algae-based and cyanobacteria-based facilities especially, they can exist anywhere in the world, anywhere with access to sunlight. And what's different now is that scientists have scoured the world looking for unique genetic variants that do what they're doing just a little bit better in terms of being able to produce the materials that we later use for fuel. And thanks to new advancements in gene editing technology, scientists have begun to improve upon those components further synthetically. Well, obviously, not to a level of bringing us carbon-neutral biofuels at the scales that we would like for our societies, but that's exactly where an emerging new field of synthetic biology can come in to try and tweak core biological processes to improve upon them even further. Because, I mean, photosynthesis, as amazing as it is still wildly inefficient at doing what it does, and new advancements like these could forever change the way we think about how we get energy from sunlight on this planet. Because if a novel cyanobacteria, just existing in a vat somewhere, in a desert facility or anywhere else with access to sunlight, can just sit there in a tube tank and take in sunlight, draw down local CO2, and produce energy, more energy than we spend trying to refine the process, we will have solved a significant component of the climate crisis. And early research results are already very promising. And some labs around the world are even experimenting with additional avenues of trying to get algae strains to do additional things besides just sitting there existing. New things like remediating the wastewater they may happen to be in, cleansing out toxic materials from the batch ponds they might be in, something to offer fuel producers another revenue stream to potentially make it more viable as something that we can do. Now, obviously, aside from sunlight, wind energy as well has evolved considerably over time to the point where a modern wind turbine, for example, can generate about 100 times more power than models from the 80s did, while costing only a fraction of what it used to cost to do so, to the point now where new research tells us that if a country like America just retrofitted all their old turbines with technology that we have now, they could already reach their 2030 energy goals. And so an outcome like that is thanks only to small but incremental, persistent new progress in new science and new technology, where an evolving science like nanotechnology, for example, could contribute with lighter but more durable materials, a great combination for turbine blades that can then potentially spin with less mechanical force needed to make the move. And in terms of talking about some of the core criticisms of, renewable energies like solar and wind, their intermittency in the sun not always being around and the wind not always blowing, advanced new science and technology can help there as well. We have a whole new suite of technologies called P2x Technologies. And they all essentially revolve around the idea that we can take excess renewable energy produced during times of plenty, like when the sun is around, and we can channel that extra energy and put it to work. And we can power up other equipment to put it into a state of potential energy that we can then cash in on when we need more energy later when the sun goes down. So, for example, we have some engineers around the world experimenting with, say, taking a reservoir of water, pumping it into a confined space so that it can be released to spring out and wash over waiting turbines to produce energy when we need it. So much like we do right now with pumped hydro, where we have a running river producing hydroelectric power, we pump just a little bit of that uphill and kind of keep it there and then release it to flow over turbines when we need extra energy. But the new innovation here that you could do that essentially anywhere in the world without needing a large river right next to your city to make it happen. Or we have the new engineers exploring the concept of using excess renewable energy to pump compressed air into confined spaces and then venting it to create kind of a mechanical force to, again, work on the same principle of moving turbine-like technology and creating excess electricity when we need it. Or we have still other engineers around the world taking excess renewable energy and using it to hoist heavy weights up to high heights in a controlled chamber where a system managed by AI can detect even micro dips in a grid's energy supply and engage to slowly lower those weights to kind of pull on a pulley mechanism to again create a mechanical force that will spin turbine-like technology and create electricity when we need it. But, I mean, all of that is entirely aside from continuous 24/7 forms of renewable energy that fewer of us tend to talk about, like geothermal energy, where new innovations are using smaller, more scalable, modular designs to take a little tank of water and then tap the immense heat that comes from deep inside the earth and use it to heat up that water, turn it into a vapor where it then rises and exerts a mechanical force on another mechanism inside the chamber to create electricity. And then when the vapors reach the other side of that barrier, cool down, turn back into liquid form, and then rejoin the initial supply. And then we can create an essentially never-ending form of continuous renewable energy that exists for as long as we have the geothermal heat there. Tidal energy, likewise, takes advantage of Earth's essentially never-ending tidal forces to create a mechanical force on equipment that we can try and use to generate electricity and augment our grid supply, especially during times after hours where the tides don't stop, when we might need just a little bit of extra power. And all of that is aside from clean but not necessarily renewable technologies like nuclear energy, where new innovations in nuclear energy will use, say, molten salt technology to lower the risk of an explosive release of gases, which FYI was already very low to begin with, that risk. Or we have other new innovations with labs swapping out potentially dangerous fuel sources like uranium with far less dangerous fuel sources like thorium. Or we have other new innovations with taking the heat that's produced during the fuel production process, piping it out for district level heating as free heat to all local communities that exist around one of those facilities. So all those kinds of innovations are taking place. And all of these new scientific and technological innovations, they all paint a slightly less grim picture, offer us a more nuanced narrative than the all bad news model would suggest. And they paint us a picture of a future in which we are taking cool new solar cell technology, placing it in cool new places, having it do cool new things we never thought that those panels could do before. Or a future in which, I don't know, we're lining the undersides of our sidewalks with compression-based energy harvesting technology from the power of human footfall, from pedestrian traffic all around our cities. Or a future in which we're taking wireless charging pads like we use for our phones now, but bigger, more powerful ones, and putting them in parking lots so an electric vehicle can just pull in over top, and placing wireless charge pads in, you know, highway rest stops and loading zones and things like that. A future in which we're pulling the hydrogen out of our vast amounts of seawater to power zero emissions transcontinental passenger flights with H2 fuel. A future in which we want to try and reverse climate change eventually by pulling down some of the CO2 in our atmosphere and trying to store it in our soils. And we have genius level bioengineers empowering crops to do that naturally, store more carbon in the soil than they otherwise naturally would have, crops that we're going to plant year after year anyway. Or a future in which we want to plant a lot more trees on our planet, but now we can much more readily with advanced technology like aerial drones that can self-pilot thanks to new innovations in imaging software coupled with satellite data that allow them to fire germinated seed pods into the ground 10 times faster than we human planters can manage by hand and far more cheaply, to the point where we have one company on paper now telling us that they're going to plant billions of trees over the years to come using precisely this kind of technology. In short, a future in which we rise to our moment, solve the climate crisis using new science and new technology coupled with all of the wonderful naturalistic options we already had, and where we don't let future generations down. Okay, thank you.